What's up guys, Ibra here with Hardware Canucks, and we're all familiar with NVIDIA's RTX launch. It's certainly an interesting topic to discuss, especially given its current state in terms of pricing. And if you recall, we did mention that we're actually working on a comparison between the RTX 2080 and an affordable aftermarket custom GTX 1080 Ti, just so you know, we paint the whole picture in terms of giving users another perspective. So definitely stay tuned for that video. But in the meantime, I decided to put RTX to its paces when it comes to video editing, because you know, for content creators like myself, a lot of people who are looking towards building a new workstation PC, especially if it's someone who's working with Adobe Premiere Pro or even DaVinci Resolve, might be looking to build, you know, an optimal workstation PC, and they might be considering RTX. So I decided to put RTX and compare it to NVIDIA's 10 series flagship, which is the 1080 Ti, to see if you're actually getting, or if you're actually benefiting out of the new GPUs. So let's check that out right after a message from our sponsor.
Evolve with the times. Consider NVMe storage today. The new RC100 brings affordable NVMe storage into your hands with various capacities in this super compact form factor that plugs directly into your motherboard. It's extremely power efficient and utilizes Toshiba's advanced 3D flash memory for awesome speeds so you can be a happy user. The RC100 by Toshiba, the NVMe drive to consider. Check it out below.
Okay, so for this test, I'll be using NVIDIA's RTX 2080 Ti Founders Edition, the most expensive consumer GPU to date. Next up, we have Zotac's Gaming RTX 2080 Amp Edition, and finally, NVIDIA's flagship 10 series GPU, the most beloved 1080 Ti. In this case, I'm using EVGA's SC or Superclocked Black Edition. Now, I'm here to test out two main factors, and the first one is playback performance, because it is an important element for content creators, because you know, when they're working with suites like Adobe Premiere Pro and of course DaVinci Resolve, you want to be able to get the best experience scrubbing through the timeline, not experience any choppiness or lag when it comes to playing back the footage in real time. So that's definitely something that we're going to be testing out on all three GPUs. And of course, the second is being rendering performance, because as much as playback performance is important, in fact, a lot better than rendering, it's again another factor for a lot of these content creators who are looking to build the workstation or an optimal workstation PC. Now, my test system consists of an Intel Core i7-8700K 6-core 12-thread processor running at stock settings. I have 32 gigabytes of Corsair Vengeance RGB memory set to 3200 megahertz, which is its XMP rated speed. I also have all of this sitting on an Asus Maximus 10 Hero motherboard. And for storage, I have Samsung's 970 EVO 1TB NVMe SSD. Do note that I have enabled the integrated UHD graphics on the 8700K through the BIOS. Remember, Premiere now takes advantage of hardware encoding with Intel CPUs that have QuickSync support to accelerate rendering times. Let's kick things off with Adobe Premiere Pro CC 2018 version 12.1.1. I loaded up a 12-minute, 37-second 4K project, primarily shot on the GH5. You guys might recall this video, it's the Lian Li PC11 dynamic case review. And starting with the EVGA GTX 1080 Ti, playback seems to be just fine with the full resolution. Albeit, I did notice maybe a few frames dropped here and there, especially with nested sequences. For example, if you have a particular shot where you have to reverse that, and if you want to add stabilization on top of that, you have to nest that particular shot, and that's obviously CPU intensive. So the 6-core 12-thread CPU might become a little bit of a bottleneck because it's got a lot of things to process. So that's why you're kind of experiencing, or that's why I ended up experiencing a few frame drops within those particular segments within this project. Interestingly enough, when I looked at the resource monitor, I noticed that the 1080 Ti was being less utilized when compared to Intel's UHD graphics. Sure, CUDA acceleration plays an important role with playback, but there is more room on the hardware side for these applications to chew through. I did notice the same trend after switching to the Zotac RTX 2080. Playback performance was pretty much identical when compared to the 1080 Ti. Switching to the RTX 2080 Ti, and what can I say, the GPU utilization, especially with dedicated graphics, didn't go over 35%. It really looks like Adobe has optimized playback performance to run as smoothly as possible by harnessing the integrated UHD graphics, along with a little bit of CUDA acceleration with GeForce cards, provided that you're on an Intel mainstream platform like, you know, Z370 or Z270, or if you're running an Intel CPU with QuickSync support. I also managed to put together a 12-minute project in DaVinci Resolve 15. Remember, this was the free version, and I made sure to enable CUDA within the preferences. And to be honest, Playback performance on all three GPUs were identical. I didn't experience any lag or choppiness. In fact, it was a little bit better than Premiere. Scrolling through the timeline was super smooth. Didn't really experience any artifacts or glitches whatsoever. And it actually got me thinking if I should switch completely from Premiere to Resolve, because the experience just after spending a day with Resolve was a lot smoother than Premiere. And yeah, I just feel like I should have learned Resolve a lot earlier than Premiere, but I'm just too lazy to learn a new NLE. That's Eber in a nutshell. I should also mention that there was 0% utilization on the UHD graphics during both playback and rendering. I'm not sure if this is a limitation with the free version versus the studio version, but it is something to keep in mind. Anyways, let's switch gears and talk about rendering performance. So starting with Adobe Media Encoder, I took that 12-minute, 37-second project, exported it to the YouTube 4K preset. Make sure you have hardware encoding enabled within the encoder settings if you're using an Intel CPU with QuickSync support. And as you can see, the difference is actually not that significant, especially if you take the RTX 2080 and the GTX 1080 Ti and put them head to head. We're talking a few seconds of difference here, which is not a big deal. Even the RTX 2080 Ti doesn't yield that much of an improvement. I did monitor system resources to see how the workload was being shared across the hardware, and just as expected, the CPU was hovering around 50%, the Intel UHD graphics was well over 70%, and the discrete NVIDIA cards I tested here were utilized between 25 to 50%. So that means you still have some resources left in the tank if you want to work on other tasks while your video is being rendered, so your system doesn't, you know, crash while basically maxing out every system resources you possibly have. Our last test here is with DaVinci Resolve 15. I took the 12-minute clip that I quickly stitched together, applied a LUT on top of that, and exported it to the YouTube 4K H.264 preset, and the results were pretty much neck to neck with the RTX 2080 Ti, the RTX 2080, and the GTX 1080 Ti. Again, it's all about hardware and software optimizations, and for fun's sakes, I decided to throw a GTX 1060 into the mix to see what the results were, and to my surprise, it took the exact same amount of time to render that 12-minute clip with DaVinci Resolve 15. And it really proves that you don't have to spend $1,000 on a graphics card to get the best editing experience. You're actually better off with the 1060 or 1070 to get a better experience because, you know, you're not really going to be taking advantage of 100% of the GPU when you're editing with programs like Resolve. Now, switching to the Adobe Media Encoder test, I think that's where things start to become a little bit different because with the 1060, it took 6 minutes longer to render when compared to the 1080 Ti, the RTX 2080, and the RTX 2080 Ti. So again, that's something that Adobe still has to work with in terms of figuring out how well can it optimize the discrete graphics card, the integrated UHD graphics, and of course the CPU. So it's certainly getting there to a point where you can rely on some of the hardware within your system. But again, Resolve is definitely tempting me to switch over. I also ended up testing the render times in Premiere with the integrated UHD graphics disabled through the BIOS. And just as expected, they were again neck to neck, but all three configurations took more than 9 minutes to complete the render. So at the end of the day, if you're looking for a discrete graphics card to accelerate video editing performance, completely skip the RTX cards, at least for now, until Adobe decides to take advantage of the Tensor cores and the RT cores. And I would actually put that money towards higher capacity memory or extra storage because those factors are very crucial for content creators. The GTX 1070, 1080, and 1080 Ti are still great options for Adobe Premiere.
The Be Quiet Dark Base Pro 900 Revision 2 is here with a modern I/O for your Type-C accessories and Qi charging gadgets. The new hub is good for 8 fans and RGB strips, plus the interior is incredibly modular for airflow, water cooling, inverted systems, and now with a power supply shroud. Check out the V2 down below.
And that about wraps up this test. I still have one more thing that I want to work on, which is just basically comparing different file formats because Premiere actually, it kind of behaves differently with different file formats, particularly with GH5 footage, Sony A7R footage as well. You've also got RED files and Canon RAW light files as well. So again, the software behaves differently with different file formats. So I want to make sure that I test those formats on both Intel's CPUs with QuickSync support and of course the X299 workstation Skylake XPCs. So yeah, it's definitely going to be quite time intensive as well. So I certainly have to spend some time testing those. Let me know if you guys are interested in that video in the comments down below. I'm Ibo with Hardware Canucks. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure to check out some relevant content over here. Subscribe to our new Boost Sequence channel for the latest tech news and rumors. I'm signing off and I'll see you guys in the next one. RTX, RTX, RTX. I'm just kidding. I don't want to. I don't want to promote RTX anymore. I mean, it's a good card. I mean, it's fast. It's the fastest GPU that's available right now. The 2080 Ti, that is. Yeah, but it's expensive, so. It's certainly an interesting topic to discuss, especially given its current state in terms of pricing. Stop! I order you to stop.